Okay, let's get started. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Over the next 20 minutes or so, I will share with you what we have done in Philips, and especially as part of this leadership engagement, which we believe that is one of the very key elements for any transformation success, right? I will actually, for your own reading, I have kept many slides so that you could always refer it back from the website. Some of those slides I will skip here, right? The introduction about me and things like that, I will skip and then try to go to the content. So I will primarily talk about leadership engagement. What do we do? I will give you a couple of challenges, how we addressed it. And the third part is I will also touch something on results. And I will also present a small model which we have worked. And then I bounced it off with other companies like Huawei, ProAwareness, and then Unisys. So these are some of the places where I had been around. And then we talked about our transformation journey. So I will present those as well. Okay. In essence, on this slide, we are running this transformation from 2014. We had the first pilots in 2014. This is the third year in our transformation. We have completed about 72 deployments in agile/scaled agile, right? So the different flavors of agile like Scrum, Kanban, TDD, the SAFe framework. We have 43 agile release trains that are running in the organization. And some of them are as huge as 240 people where we have split it into value streams and agile release trains, right? We have about 50 plus SPCs on board in Philips who are driving this transformation, and roughly about 70% are from the business side of it. We have an end goal transformation target that we would certify about 3,000 people in this whole transformation journey over a period of 3 years. And we have something like 1674 certificates that are there, and quite a bit of honors and awards across. And the latest being that Dean Leffingwell has blogged about the SAFe journey in Philips, right? So that's the latest. And we are invited to many forums like this and to companies where we share our transformation journey. Okay, so it's a global presence. We have about 20 coaches. I will skip that, right? So moving on, right? We start with something called as a executive session with leaders, right? So this is what we address the vice president level, the CEO level of the organization. The people who can make the decision, right? Who can set the direction, who can set the vision. Because one thing is, if the message doesn't come from the leadership, if it doesn't come from the top, right? It's almost like a lip service. If it succeeds, it succeeds, right? Otherwise, if it doesn't go through, I stand at the edge of a change curve to see whether it would fall or whether it would continue, okay? So, we set up this four-hour leadership session with the executives, and then sell some of these key concepts, like set the vision, tell why we are doing this, why it is needed, right? I also invite you to look into Simon Sinek's the messages with why, and how do you address the intrinsic part of the brain. I would come to a little bit of those aspects as well as we continue. The difference between profit motivators and purpose motivators. Could you bring out the intrinsic motivation of the teams or the people whom we are going to work with? Okay. Building high performance team versus just telling or being a task manager or being a command and control manager. If you can leave things to the team, would they be delivering it for you? Okay, how you should address those messages, right? So that's where we get into it. Leading the transformation change, right? And the next one here on safety net, which we value very highly. The two pillars of this safety net is that, one is trust, the second is transparency, right? If it is not anchored in these two pillars, it would not succeed. So as a leader, right, you know, how can you enable the teams for them to fail? Okay, so will I have the confidence that, you know, if I fail, I wouldn't be punished? Just look into the day before example, Rahane, right? The team management completely stood behind him. If you had looked into averages, the last 10 test matches, he was scoring something between 12 to 15. That was his average, right? Anil Kumble made a statement that there is no talk about anything being done with Rahane. This is bullshit. Stop this. That's the statement he made in the press conference. Look what it would. What Anil has done is, and the management, they just built that safety net for him. Okay? So anchored on the pillars of trust and transparency. So as leaders, how you can get into that? So that's what I mean by safety nest and fail fast culture there. Leader as developer, okay? Don't indulge in transactional leadership with your team. I would come back to this particular element little later with a very good example, right? You know, so this was there in the paper yesterday, so I would come back, okay? As I said, we always start with the executive level leadership training, and this is completely, you know, the top cream of the organization. Okay, it's a 4 hours training, and we cover some very related exercises related to all these key topics, and then, you know, we take them to the transformation route. If you look at it, the leadership, the R&D management, again, I will provide a small connection in the next slide, you know, how the whole thing flows through. And then it also gets into the program management, and then the teams. Basically here, I have tried to pictureize the 4 levels of SAFe, and you know, which leader has to be addressed on what part of it. And on the right-hand side, what you see is there, you see the teams starting from day-to-day tasks, the user stories, the features, and how they get into it. So basically, it is a top-down as well as a bottom-up where the entire organization is covered, right? Including the teams, they are actually looked as leaders in their own right as well as might. Because if you tell them just what to do, right, you would just be creating followers in the long run. If you give them the purpose and tell them, why are we doing this? Why are we in this particular business, okay? What is your part in it? And then you actually create those leadership irrespective of whatever is the level of that particular person in the organization. Okay, so again, organizing the teams around silos or organizing the team around value. What you see on the left hand side is that a traditional hierarchy based organization, from the time any message that comes from the top to the team, right? If you actually look into typical lead times, it would be, let's say, you know, it would be a month, it would be 2 months, depending upon, you know, the how the organization is. And many a times, I see people talking to teams like, you know, you will get to know what you need to know. It means that the different leaders at various levels are just acting as filters and buffers. So the whole paradigm shifts to in terms of the more information I have and the more information I would say I conceal, okay, that much of power I have, which is absolutely a very wrong notion. And that is not something which would succeed as you move on, right? So these are all nothing but the leadership is following the silo mentality, okay? So one of the vice presidents was there in one of our sessions, and then, you know, we were talking about, we have a concept called as one roof integration, which is again a good paradigm. And then, you know, he just said that, can I go there to the one roof integration? I said, who stopped you? Okay. And then he actually went to the one, and then, you know, the way he positioned himself going into the one roof team, where about 40 people from different disciplines are there, right from the developers to it. He said, I am an impediment remover. If you have any issues, talk to me. Okay, this is the message he gave. And then, you know, it's a fantastic, successful product. And you know, he just blogged around it, stating that how the teams were motivated, how he was motivated with the whole agile concept. So again, you know, see, nobody asked him not to go, right? So it's all the own inhibitions that, you know, we just try to move it away from here. And that's what you see here in the agile management, where you say that, you know, focus on speed. And the most important thing, what is the feedback that you could get back from the customer or the stakeholder or to the marketing who are going to be the users of your product. Okay, and the whole thing, what it would result is in decentralized decision making, because it is the team which is taking the decisions. It is not the leadership who are taking the decision. Does it mean that as a leader, I need not have to make decisions? You make decisions what is needed for your level, most important thing, right? Leave the decisions that the team has to make to the team, because otherwise, you know, what you are actually trying to do is nothing but a command and control structure, which has to be completely dismantled. So that's the essence of this particular slide. Are you organized around values or are you organized around silos? If you follow the left-hand side model, you are in a silo. If you are following the right-hand side model, okay, you are trying to organize people around values. Okay, some of these things, right, you know, again, what is the competency that has to be exhibited by the leader? If you look at it, I will actually, you know, the left-hand side are the ones, you know, which are more like, you know, driving execution, because the teams are there to do it. Right? Why you have to be redundant? Should the top level leader or somebody, you know, should every day come to the floor and say that, you know, okay, these are the tasks you have to do for it. Okay? Are you moving people to the work or are you moving work to the people? Okay? So if you have an agile board or a one single truth of transparency, you know what is the work that needs to be done. Okay, and then once the people see the work, they will actually pull the work themselves, depending upon what competencies they have around. Okay, and I know some of the things, right, you know, we talked about impediment remover. I gave an example for you. Okay, and look into the mindset, right? We very well hear the concepts of servant leadership. Anybody, what servant leadership is about? Absolutely. The key word, enabling people, okay? I am here to serve, right? Many people get it like, you know, so when you say to a scrum master that, you know, you need to look at servant leadership, so the question is my task to go and bring a cup of water, bread, and milk to the team? Okay, see, because these are all negative paradigms, you know, which gets into people's mind, right? So the whole thing about, am I enabling something? Am I making people to do much more than they can do is what is missing. So those are some of the things. For example, when a vice president goes and says in a room and, you know, says that my job is to remove impediments, look at the power it is going to make for the teams. Okay, pivot and adapt. That's what is adaptive leadership, right? You know, changing course, tuning yourself on what exactly is the needs and how you are going to make it happen. Incremental development, joint ownership, right, we saw about it. The message what I want to say here is command and control versus intent-based, okay? If you give what is the intent, you would unlock the intrinsic motivation of the person. And you would even see a change in the vocabulary itself, right? You know, because this is where the culture of an organization changes, right, from behavior to patterns, pattern to habit to culture. This is actually a circular model, right? So if you want to change that, this is where the first step for your, the cultural shift in your organization. Asking things like, you know, I want this. I have done my MPP. You will by default follow this Microsoft project plan and you would give it to it. Next team meeting, we will have a review, okay? Versus, right, what is your idea? Can we do this? Do you think that this is feasible? Or do you have a better solution? Do you have a better idea? Okay, can we change the vocabulary around it? Right, the second thing is, right, this is my thinking. I have been here for 10 years in this organization. I know how things will work in this organization. Right, so it means that all the boundaries are already created and then whoever comes in just needs to follow those aspects. Vis-a-vis changing like, hey, what do you feel, right? Do you think that this is the most optimal thing to do with? Do you think that, you know, can we do some automation around it? The IP sprints are the best examples where, you know, you can bring the best creative things in your people. In this slide, what we want to say is that we tell the leaders very clearly, okay, if you actually look into it, the why part of it. We tell the leaders, just tell the why to the teams and leave what is to be done or the execution part to the teams, right? And when the why and what of an organization comes together, that is where your value would be created. For value, again, I repeat, please ensure that you focus on outcomes, right? Do not focus on outputs, right? So saying that, you know, I am actually driving value, don't go to the teams and say that from now onwards, you know, I want an increase in your velocity number from 20 story points to 30 story points, okay? It doesn't work that way, okay? What is the outcome? What is the feature that we are going to talk about it? What is the product capabilities that are going to be done, okay? What are the new things that are going to come in? So those are some of the things. And we have coined this, you know, we actually call it as, we actually talk to the researchers as well, right? The what we call as the right dose, okay? You would have heard about this concept, the EDSO. So I have just rephrased it as dose. There are four neurochemicals in our brain, okay? They are actually called as dopamine, oxytocin, serotonin, and endorphin. Dopamine is a chemical, right, you know, which works on the reward behavior. You send a message in Facebook or WhatsApp, okay? And from that moment onwards, look in terms of how many times you would be seeing your mobile. Basically, you want to know, hey, how many people has liked mine? Okay, how many people have liked mine? Has he left a comment? Okay, so this is actually a reward driving behavior, and be careful for using it, because many of the leaders would use this for the wrong way. Basically, like, you know, if you tune an employee to say that if you do this, you will get this much hike. If you do this, 3 years from now, you would get the promotion. Okay, if you do this, this is how you would grow, because what you are working on is a dopamine behavior. Okay, so look into it. The second one is, you know, oxytocin. What is the bond that creates between a baby and child? You would see, you know, as soon as the baby is there, the mother holds the baby towards the chest. Basically, there is a bonding that gets created between the baby and the mother, right? So just imagine, you know, you walk into the office, right? And then one of your colleagues says, good morning, okay? Behaviors. Have you done all the tasks of whatever I gave you yesterday? Okay? Or can you just step in and say, hey, good morning to you. How are you doing? How are you feeling? Do you need anything? Do you need any help for what I gave you yesterday? Right? All it takes is about 10 seconds vis-a-vis your behavior of, like, you know, yes, right? So that's the oxytocin bond that you would be creating to the team. Imagine serotonin, okay? This is also called as the leadership chemical. This basically, it means that, what is it in for me? Why do I exist? Basically, the person transcends all the planes and then, you know, try to give something back to the environment, back to the family, right? And, you know, for example, simple thing like, you know, you want your child to be the best in whatever field he or she chooses to be. Because, right, you know, you don't expect anything back from the child, right? You know, you transcend yourself to the next higher level. So that's actually the serotonin, or also this is called as the organization chemical, okay? Coming back to Rahane's example, I was reading it. What he said was, for the whole about 35 overs, the only thinking that was there in his mind is to block as many number of balls possible and then take singles. Okay, he could have, like, you know, after getting 40 or whatever it is, he played something like about 30 overs or so overall. And then if you look at it, what is it, the much higher purpose, the team, the country, which needs to move from its present position to the next higher position? Serotonin, that chemical works in it, okay? Endorphin, these are people where, you know, who are like, you know, the brilliant scientists or those sort of people where it's always something that, you know, they want to achieve something at the next higher level, okay? So you should know how to motivate. You could have seen some people working for a day, if there is a problem, unless and until that person works day and night for that problem and resolves it without tea, coffee, lunch, water, whatever that it may be, okay, those are the serotonin chemicals that works. It's also called as the runner's high. Look at marathon runners, right? If you have tried running, just try running for 2 to 3 kilometers for a week, I would say, because one-time wonders are always possible, where 2 days you can do it. And look at the amount of pain your body would experience through. Okay, it's called as the runner's high. Why do I want to do it? Okay, the serotonin. These are also called as the happy chemicals. We talk to leaders on such terminologies. Okay, just on decentralized decision making, I will quickly run through the next two slides. This is a product worth about something like 10 million, right, where the teams had come up with features for the next 8 program increments. Okay, which means that, does it mean that there won't be any changes that are happening? Now the team has committed that the next 2 PIs or the program increments, this is what we would do. And then rest of the things, depending upon how the market reacts, okay, we would change in. So who takes the decision? It is the team. It is not that, you know, somebody from the product management or to the pipeline and portfolio guys who have told that, you know, this is what it is, this is what you should do, and things like that. Yeah. Okay. Actually, on the trainings, if you look at it, there is a saving of about 1.2 million. This is from my program, direct. And this whole thing is handled by an administrative assistant from my team. Okay, and this is the savings that is there, because all that has been told to her is that, okay, you would run all these things on your own. Okay, you come with what is the way it is, and my job is only to be an impediment remover. Okay, so when you get into a transformation journey, so like, you know, as I said, that trust and transparency, the two key pillars, and as leaders, you are supposed to provide the safety net. Okay, so the teams, the moment they hear about the agile concept, they quickly move. Okay, now the middle management feels that, hey, the team is doing something, I don't know what it is. There is some chaos happening here. So there is a friction that happens, and then, you know, you feel that, that friction comes in. When we go to the leadership and talk to them about the leadership value, self-organizing, how you can make things and things like that, right, they are immediately motivated by this, because for the first time they feel, hey, I can talk to the team directly. I need not have multiple layers. So again, there is a friction because the next level leadership is not ready for it. Okay, that's where, and then the management slowly confused which way to go. Should I go with the team? Should I go with the leadership? Right, and then they start moving on it. Okay, and imagine the organization moves slowly. If you leave it too much behind like this, then again you will have a friction, because you will feel that organization is not supporting the agile processes. But we would advise caution there. The organization has to be one step below the whole agility in terms of compliance in, for the quality, regulation, and so on. Otherwise, what would happen is we would try to violate so many things. So it is better that there is a team which is responsible for the checks and balances. Okay, how to make changes stick? We have a good communities of practice that are there, and then the SPCs whom we have trained, they themselves take care of things in the organization. One thing which we have very clearly institutionalized is that the many of these leaders share their success stories with the other peers. Okay, see, we have something like about 16 or 17 business groups, about 69 business units. So we bring all these people together. Okay, that's the forum which helps in these things. 44 trains and 220 plus increments, you know, either software, system, and so on. What cannot be measured, cannot be managed, right? So there is good amount of results that comes in either for regression or KPIs. This one, what you see as software business A, is the multiple value streams for different products, okay? Those sort of aspects. Here, I just wanted to say that fun at work and all those things, and I'm not touching too much on these things. The only thing which I want to tell is that last year, 2016, the value realized by our program, right, in running this transformation is something like 22 million euros. Okay, so my overall budget is about 3 million euros, and you see what is the impact that it has created. Okay, so in essence, we start with an executive level sessions, okay? The EDSO or the right dose, what I call it as, leading to value delivery. Organizing between values and silos, basically look into the team concept and check how many layers are you doing it. The fail fast culture and the safety net, right? Allow people to do their best in their job. And you be supportive to them, okay? Residual command and challenges to intent-based leadership. Just to want to give an example here. Yesterday, I don't know how many of you read the article. There was one article which was circulating. It said that if you are 35 years and in an IT industry, okay? I see many nods, so I think majority of you seen it. The message is if you are 35 years old and in an IT industry, expect the pink slip shortly. Okay, this is the message, right? If you look at it, why? What is the reason for it? And then Capgemini CEO has given a message that 65% of these people cannot be reskilled. One of the fundamental things for this is that, let's say the engineer has come to job at the age of 21, for about 15 years, right? They have been made to follow only commands. Okay, so you find yourself in a situation where you cannot move to the next level because the brain has tuned to only the command. I always need to look for someone else to do what is my next assignment. And then suddenly, when you move into automation, blah, 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 and all those stuff, you feel that you are completely out of tune. Right? So if only as a leader, if you had planted that particular seed of why, and made that person as your next level leader, okay, you wouldn't be in this situation. Leadership doesn't mean you have to lead only people, okay? Every action, every activity, whether you do it at home or work or anywhere, okay, how much of thinking that goes behind your action, okay, is a leadership. Are you just planting an apple seed to get the next apple tree, or are you planting those seeds to get your next apple orchard? Okay, that's where the leadership thinking is. And then coming back to the engineers, if only they had questioned the status quo, right? By saying that, what, leave it to me. What I can do it differently. I see a lot of smiles there, right? If only that status quo had been challenged by the engineers themselves, okay? So you would avoid this particular situation. So both to leaders and to teams, over here, right? Evaluate for yourself, think for yourself where you want to be, right? Do you want to create your next level leaders, right? Or for the team, do I want to be the leader, right? So with that thought, I leave you there. Thanks.